How many of you flew into Paris today or yesterday? Yeah? How many of you, even if you had gold status, had to queue up somewhere, either at security or at check-in somewhere? Wow, a lot of you have gold status, it seems. The thing is, today I can only imagine three places in the world where we still need to queue up. The airport, like that. The post office, and Disneyland. And there's only one of those three places where we are actually happy queuing up, Disneyland. Now, interestingly, this morning I flew in from Toronto, and at Toronto Airport, they've actually taken a leaf out of Disneyland's book. The queues are so long in the morning, by the way, that they now have jigsaw puzzles and crosswords in the queue for you to pass your time. And by the way, they're all to do with aviation, so it was kind of fun for me to do. But guess what? Airports are learning. But today, the result of queuing is actually different. And I've got a little video to show you to show what exactly I mean here, okay? If you can switch to the video, please. Now, I have a quick question, and whoever can give me the right answer to this question, I will sign a book for you right now, okay? Who can tell me which movie this scene is from? You got that wrong! What's that? Meet the Parents. It is indeed. Meet the Fockers was number two. Meet the Parents was the first one. What's your name?
Peter Donaldson.
Peter. All right, so that's an easy one.
It is.
It's not as hard as my name. There you go.
You win that one.
That's for you, yeah.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. So, can anyone tell me, now I don't have another book to give away, but who can tell me which year Meet the Parents came out? Any guesses? The year was 2000, so 99 was close. The year was 2000, 18 years ago. Well, 17 years ago. And interestingly, just for 2 minutes, okay, put yourself in the shoes of the boss of that lady, okay? This is her annual assessment. Did she smile? Did she break any rules? Was she firm? Did she allow anyone to jump the queue? Guess what? Perfect employee, promoted. Right? But if this is to happen today, not so easy. Because guess what? The guy's going to have a smartphone in his hands, the airplane is going to have Wi-Fi, and he's going to tweet the hell out of it. Before the flight lands, there'll be a hashtag trending, and our dear John Walton and Seth and all his friends will be chiming in on whether the airline was right or not. Everyone is going to be on it before the flight lands, because everyone today has the power to be a reporter, has the power to report live, and this is what I mean by the enraged customer. The enraged traveler today is carrying multiple devices, is reporting live from within the plane. And there are stats to show this. I mean, the connected travelers of today are carrying multiple devices. 97% of them have some form of device. I mean, the electronics ban has been catastrophic in the lives of some people. They just cannot live with their devices. There's FOMO and other stuff coming in. You know, many of them bring tablets. You've got laptops, phones. Whoever travels without a smartphone these days? And guess what? That gives them the power to report live whatever's happening. Now, I'm not going to show the video. I'm sure all of you have seen it. But that gives them the power to go inside the cabin, show whatever is happening, live or recorded, and guess what? The news is out there. But interestingly, is the news out there? That's the question we got to ask. Is it the right news that's out there? Is it just a part of the story that's being seen? And guess what? When the news gets out there in this fashion, it actually impacts the airlines quite badly. United Airlines stock price dipped over $1 billion before jumping back up. And that's serious business impact, right? And this is where I come in and question, what is the role of a good journalist? If the report is getting out, if things are being live streamed, if everything is already out there, what is your role as a good journalist? It's certainly evolved. It's surely not to be the first one to have the news out. It's surely not to have breaking news as we see on CNN on every second thing, right? So if it's not breaking news, then what is it? And that's the question I'm trying to answer, because a lot of you here are award winners. All of you certainly are very prolific writers to be at this dinner ceremony and the award ceremony. So what is it that good journalists do that is different? Well, there are three things that I would like to suggest, and I know a lot of you already do, and I will share examples. The first is that a good journalist verifies the fact. What's being seen is not necessarily the whole truth, as a lot of us know about United, or a week later, American Airlines and the stroller gate that happened, which also went viral. Social media has the tendency to only showcase one side of the story, and guess what? People will just click on it again and again and again if it's interesting or disruptive enough, and many people, Sunday morning, that's all they want to do. And airlines are easy scapegoats as well, right? The second thing is subject matter experts are trusted. A lot of you are experts in operations, in passenger experience, and many other fields. And that's important, because a journalist who's a subject matter expert builds trust. And if you're a trusted voice, then people listen to you. And that's important. And finally, a journalist reports the full story, doesn't leave certain things out to get clicks, for example. And that's a controversial one. And I will share with you examples of all three that I've seen happen lately. So are all of you familiar with Flight Radar 24? Yeah? Or AirLive? These services will tweet out a distress signal from an aircraft the moment the pilot switches to squawk 7700, 7500, 7600. There was once where we got in touch with the airline, who then called the operations center, and the operations center did not know what Flight Radar had already tweeted. The thing is, just read that tweet. That's an automatic tweet, right? It just shows a diversion. Guess what? That kind of a tweet is ripe for rumors. Is it a diversion because of a medical reason? Is it a diversion because of an engine fire? What is the cause? We don't really know. And that's when good journalists like Tom Podolek, whom I know in Canada, get in, speak to the airline and say, oh, by the way, diverted because of medical reasons. I was speaking with someone from Cathay Pacific the other day, and it turns out Cathay Pacific has actually forged an official partnership with Flight Radar 24 that within 2 minutes of something happening, Flight Radar 24 will be given the reason for a diversion or one of the squawk codes, and Flight Radar 24 will actually tweet the reason out. So that's the first thing. Facts need to be verified, and you as journalists are the ones who know this stuff, not the guy sitting at the gate who's enraged just tweeting out live, right? He or she probably just doesn't know what is going on. Secondly, be the expert. And here I share an example from Runway Girl, Mary Kirby. And a lot of us in the room know her and her work and her team's work, and they are the experts in passenger experience. So when Runway Girl publishes something about Finnair and their design being good, people take that seriously, right? Because they are experts in passenger experience. You have to think, what are you an expert in? What is it that you have an audience for who will listen to you and close their eyes and trust you? Trust is very important. And finally, reporting the whole story. Now, these are actual images from a news site. This was Singapore Airlines flight about 3 years ago from Singapore to London. There was severe turbulence over Mumbai. And the turbulence was encountered right after dinner service was done. So the trays were not cleared at that point. What happened was there was severe turbulence and people took pictures. As we all know, the enraged traveler, right? They took pictures and pictures and pictures. It showed the damage that was done. It showed the mess the flight was in. It showed coffee on the ceiling. This is an A380, by the way, so that's some severe turbulence. It also showed all the rubbish that was around, and you know, once the seatbelt sign was off, what was happening. It showed the actions flight attendant took, and then the final result. 90% of the websites stopped here. We had these pictures, by the way, are from The Mirror UK. Not the most credible of websites, but still, everyone else copied The Mirror because it was a sensational headline. Coffee hits the ceiling. Like, teeth hits the fan. Coffee hits the ceiling. And almost everyone stopped here, but there were two publications whom I know in this room, Flight Global and ATW. They went beyond and they shared one more picture, just one more, which only one passenger has shared. They shared this picture. When the flight landed in Singapore, Singapore Airlines ground staff gave every single passenger, 500 of them, a box of chocolates to apologize for the turbulence that they encountered. Now, imagine if you're a passenger on this flight, you go home and you're sharing chocolates with your friends and relatives. Guess what? We're going to be talking about chocolates and not turbulence, right? And that is the whole picture. That is what our roles are as journalists going forward, because the enraged traveler who has just the mobile phone in hand is reporting one perspective and one story arc, the single story arc. You got to report the real story arc, or the zero story arc, not the first story arc. And that's what is key, because ultimately, we as journalists and reporters and media need trust and build trust, and it's the trust that ultimately works and differentiates us from the enraged traveler who's got two smartphones and tweeting out live with 24 followers on Twitter and with the egghead as photo often, right? And that's the key difference, because ultimately, the difference between an airline facing a can of worms or a box of chocolates is you guys. Thank you very much. Thank you.